guys! I decided for my second ever YouTube video that I wanted to talk about some of the books that I read in the month of April. I definitely have been reading a lot more now that we're in Circuit Breaker here in Singapore. And also today is Vesak Day, which is a Buddhist holiday, so I have the day off, so I have some time, and I wanted to just talk about some of my favorite books for the month of April. So the first one is actually nonfiction. It's called Singapore Incomplete by Cherry and George, and it was written, or it was published in 2017, so it's a pretty recent book. This guy is pretty well known, I would say, if you are living in Singapore or interested in Singapore. I think his most well-known book done for a general audience is called Air Conditioned Nation, which I also have, but I haven't read it yet. Currently, he's an academic, but he was previously a journalist, and he worked at Straits Times for many years before being a professor at Nanyang Technology University, NTU, and then essentially he was forced out of Singapore not in the same sense of being a dissident, maybe so much like in China or in Hong Kong, where he really had his livelihood threatened, but I will say he's a political figure, and so now he's in Hong Kong working at a different university because it wouldn't be possible for him to do what he wanted to do here in Singapore. From the book jacket, the description says, following Lee Kuan Yew's death and the ruling party's resounding 2015 election victory, and as the government prepares to transition to a fourth-generation leadership, Cherry and George contemplates the unfinished business of political liberalization and multicultural integration. He calls for a more open system that will protect and celebrate a diversity of ideas and beliefs. So I really, really, really like this book. I think this is my favorite type of writing style. It's written by a journalist, so the writing style is very succinct and concise and to the point. You can tell he was a journalist because it's accessible language, but because he's now in academia, it's also very deep in the sense that he's thought about these issues for a long time. He has molded over. There's a lot of nuance to what he's saying. Each chapter is only 5 to 7 pages. They're really short. They're the perfect length. I'm just such a fan of the structure of the book. And each of them has a very clear headline of what George is trying to get across. And then the writing style itself is just extremely snappy, and it covers pretty much every topic. It's like the canon of issues that a politically active Singaporean cares about. And I think it's pretty comprehensive. I don't really think he's missed much. There are chapters on race and religion and kind of delving into the whole premise of racial harmony and a multicultural society that Singapore was founded on. So he talks about immigration, the population size of Singapore rapidly expanding, and xenophobia is a key theme, how the electoral system works, how the parliamentary system works in terms of is it rigged against the opposition, why PAP leaders are kind of allergic to the word democracy. Those type of topics were extremely interesting for me because it takes it like one level deeper and explains how Singaporean politics and the political system works. He talks about like the institution of the presidency, which I didn't realize was a pretty recent addition actually. So for example, one of the chapters is called The LKY Legacy. And then the headline is, Lee Kuan Yew isn't to blame if Singapore can't let go of him. And then I would say the last bucket or the last few themes that are really addressed in this book all have to do with media, independent journalism, censorship, the influence of the government or the PAP when it comes to trying to have a healthy or robust media system, and kind of also how that's playing out in this day and age with the internet. He says that the target audience of this book is the future of the PAP, the young PAP leaders and maybe the 5G or 6G really generation of leaders that are going to be in the PAP, which I think is really interesting and I really appreciate because it kind of straddles this middle ground in the sense that, I mean, the PAP has always been in control in Singapore, and I think George, he says that he agrees with a lot of the policies and he agrees with a lot of the motivations behind the policies, and he doesn't buy that just because it's one party rule and has only ever been one party rule, that in itself makes it a problem. Rather, he is trying to really demonstrate respect for what Singapore has become, which is a much more mature and evolved nation. And he doesn't think that there needs to be such strong control or scrutiny. There's actually, okay, so the quote on the back is, ours is a middle-aged country with a maturing economy, but a political system that treats us like children. You can tell that all of his suggestions and all of his insights are really, they come from a good place because he's trying to make the country a more diverse and a more tolerant place in the sense of allowing opposition viewpoints both in politics and in society to have a space to play. And so this is really just up my alley. I'm not a fan of like just straight full-on criticism with no nuance. And you know, a lot of the Western critiques of Singapore come from a place of ignorance about Asia and come from a place of it just comes from a different place, right? Because they're not, there's a whole slew of reasons why you can't really understand a country if you're not from there and you haven't really been embedded in that society and in the politics. I think sometimes I am a bit conflicted because I really want to extol a lot of the amazing aspects of Singapore, but then at the same time, I do think there are very valid criticisms of the political system and a variety of things, inequality, poverty, all of the topics that he covers. And so a lot of times it kind of feels like you're stuck in this trap of you can't praise Singapore, but I also don't want to just rag on it. And this is the perfect book to kind of just take a step back and say, hey, here are all the great things about Singapore that we can all agree upon, but A, B, C, D, E, F, G is where there needs to be improvement and there needs to be discussion. And he explains why it doesn't seem that there is a space for these topics to be discussed in today's society. You definitely need to have knowledge of Singaporean politics and current events before delving into this. I had a lot of impressions. I've lived here, but I now want to be educated on various viewpoints and assessments of these issues, including housing, the media. I'm really into like the politics. I think it's fascinating, stuff like that. To rate this book, if you could not tell, I really liked it. So I'm gonna give it a 9.5 out of 10. Definitely like for this style, for this genre, for what it's trying to be and for what it did for me. And would definitely recommend to anyone who is interested in learning more about Singapore. The second book I want to talk about is called Shrill, and it's by Lindy West. It came out in 2017. I'll read the little summary. Shrill is an uproarious memoir, a feminist rallying cry in a world that thinks gender politics are tedious and that women, especially feminists, can't be funny. Lindy West is a Seattle-based writer, editor, and performer whose work focuses on pop culture, social justice, humor, and body image. The various stories of her life that she tells really explore what it's like to be fat, what it's like to be a woman, and kind of all of the scrutiny and abuse even that she's had to deal with throughout her life. And so I think for me it was really interesting to see her perspective in terms of how in a lot of ways it's still perfectly okay to be quite cruel to fat people, especially in American pop culture and American media. And she tells a lot of stories or anecdotes from her childhood. You know, growing up, the only role models that she ever saw in media were always stick thin, and she only had like Miss Piggy. As someone who hasn't dealt with that, it really helps to open your eyes and serves as sort of an education around all of the friction and hate that the world gives someone who's overweight. Her tone is very witty. It's kind of like she just transplants the tone that you would use on Twitter or in an online blog into the written form. The way she writes is kind of the way she might speak, and it's kind of that rambling casual. I mean, it's still compelling and it's not overly colloquial, but she does that thing where she just kind of rambles and then inserts a lot of parentheses or has a lot of footnotes that are sarcastic or like witty rejoinders. So the reflections that she tells about being a woman online who's also fat are really interesting, both being online and also being in comedy. In particular, when people started knowing what she looked like and started consuming her content, how that led to tons of trolling and online abuse. And there is a very interesting chapter, I think it's also an article, where she talks about confronting one of her trolls. And this troll had created a fake Twitter account pretending to be her deceased father, so like very cruel. And she confronts him and he says, you know, the reason I decided to attack you is because you seem so confident and happy in who you are, and I hate myself, which kind of, I think, sums up the whole memoir, which is she just in being a fat woman, faced so much cruelty and hate from the world. I think particularly in the U.S., I think this is definitely true, where there is just this need to blame fat people for being fat and to blame it on personal choices instead of looking at what are the systemic factors behind it and why do we as a society, instead of trying to address those issues, instead attack fat people. I thought that was like a very key theme that she hits that made a lot of sense. And then she also has a couple chapters around rape jokes and kind of being a fat woman in the comedy scene. Just the fact that rape is gendered violence, it's kind of like you're choosing someone who's already a victim and using their trauma to make a joke. So, I mean, I obviously agreed with that and thought that she described it in an interesting way, but it's not really like opinion writing. It is definitely still in the memoir style. By reflecting on these events in her life, she kind of hits you with what she thinks about them and her opinions. I think I gave this book a 7 out of 10. A lot of interesting ideas. Her life is interesting. Her perspective is interesting. Sometimes the writing style is a bit annoying, like it just kind of grates on you. But I think that's more my personal preference. It was sometimes a little bit too tongue-in-cheek. And the cool thing is the memoir is being spun into a TV show. I feel like there's a big dearth of authentic and nuanced representation of fat people in media, and so the fact that her memoir was really successful and then she used it as a jumping off point to create this TV show, which I think has been received really well, is awesome. The next book I want to talk about is Woman Warrior, Memoir of a Girlhood Among Ghosts by Maxine Home Kingston, and this was published in 1976. This was also under the theme of memoirs by women and on the list from my book club. Shout out to my book club members, Bella, Chris, Sherry, and some previous people who have quit. The writing is just very powerful and hits you deep. Like, it hit me in my soul for many parts of it. And it's just beautiful. The words she uses are beautiful. The turns of phrase are beautiful. And her overall writing style is this kind of mix of memoir and myth that just creates this like swirling, almost mystical, but still insightful kind of atmosphere that you're absorbing these stories that she tells you. So the first chapter, which is called No Name Woman, is about her mother's sister-in-law who commits suicide during, I think it's the period between like after World War II and before the Cultural Revolution, but she's still a peasant, like she's still in the countryside and it's village life. And she commits suicide because she's been raped and she has a child, and this would bring dishonor to her family because everyone's starving and they don't want another mouth to feed, but in particular, they don't want another unmarried woman who's had a daughter to take care of. So she commits suicide, and that really introduces the key concepts around women are worthless, especially in China during that time. The main character's mother, who's telling her this story, says, "You can never bring this up. She must remain nameless." And there's another key thread throughout each of the chapters around the importance of being named and the importance of having a descendant's line. And, you know, during Hungry Ghost Festival, if you didn't have the proper naming, you would just be a wandering ghost because your ancestors wouldn't be able to find you, or vice versa, and so you wouldn't be able to receive the tributes from them. That kind of sets the scene for Kingston's exploration of legacy and family and what it means to be a woman and trying to carry on your family name, and how she, as the protagonist, wants to respect and honor this aunt who has been so disgraced. The second chapter is kind of a folk story, so that's what lends to this like very textured, swirling feel that feels like Kingston is drawing from some like very deep source, like spinning these tales, because she uses, you know, a story from China in the 50s. The next chapter is really told in the folk story style, which is about a young girl who gets taken away by immortals and trained to become a woman warrior or a woman avenger. And then she also becomes Mulan somehow. I think she kind of like combines two folk stories together, but it's also the story of Mulan and how powerful this woman warrior is, but she couldn't reveal that she was a woman. The third chapter, which is called Shaman, is about Kingston's mother, or the protagonist's mother, and she's studying to be a doctor in Guangzhou at Zhongsheng Dashue, or Sun Yat-sen University, and the powers that she has as the smartest, but a bit older, student in her all-women's college, and her ability to scare ghosts and not be afraid of ghosts, and Kingston kind of talks about like the different types of ghosts, and the ghost theme, the womanhood theme, it's always throughout the entire memoir, so those are some really strong sources of imagery and symbolism, and also folklore that she kind of hints at throughout the book. The last two chapters are really more about life in the US, and so her mom's sister coming to the Bay Area to be reunited with her husband that she hasn't seen in decades, I think, and who already has a new family with a white woman and with American children. And then the last chapter is really more about her struggles as a first generation Chinese American. I did want to share just a couple quotes because I think it does sum up what I'm trying to describe really well. So the first one I have is, "When Chinese girls listen to the adults talk story, we learned that we failed if we grew up to be but wives or slaves. We could be heroines, swordsmen. Even if she had to rage all across China, a swordswoman fought even with anybody who hurt her family. Perhaps women were once so dangerous that they had to have their feet bound, and it was a woman who invented white crane boxing only 200 years ago." And I think that quote is helpful because while a lot of the memoir is Kingston mourning the position of women and having this like very emotional reckoning with her own self-value and the value that her family and her culture places on women, she doesn't just paint it in that light. There's also a lot of strength and honor in being a woman warrior, and she describes stories in particular from Chinese culture that really vaunt and lift up women. So I don't think it's kind of just a one-wash criticism of the role or treatment of women in ancient or modern China. I do think it also is her way of showing that women were valued and can be strong in a lot of the mythology, but it's a complex relationship, right? So in general, I had a very emotional and deep reaction to the book. The only thing that I had as kind of a negative experience in reading it that I thought was kind of weird was when Kingston would do this thing of literally translating Mandarin words or Chinese words, I guess, and then using the English to make the phrase sound more exotic. So in the quote I just read, she does this a lot. She says talk story, which I think is 讲故事 in Mandarin. And so literally translated 讲故事 means talk story. So she, I think, is trying to imbue additional meaning to that word by referring to the fact that storytelling has like a deep and rich history in China, and that she's also telling stories in her memoir, and this is a collection of stories, and it's also secondhand stories and folklore, so it's all these types of stories, and so storytelling is very central to her book. But I also just think it's weird because it's just a literal translation. That's how she's using it, so that's fine. But I think if you actually speak both languages, it comes off as a little cheap. The one that really stuck out to me is the words stenciled on the box mean fragile, but literally say use a little heart. And so by saying use a little heart, I don't know, she's trying to make it more poignant, I guess, but in Mandarin, 用小心 is like so common, and it's just what you say when you're trying to say be careful. Like, you know, if you took apart English words into their subparts and traced them back to their German origin to like then make it more meaningful in German or whatever etymological origin it has, it just seems like kind of weird. And the fact that she does it because Chinese is already like exotified by a white audience, I wouldn't necessarily levy this as a criticism, but I noticed it and I thought it was weird. Which is a good segue into some of the criticisms of this writing, which I found fascinating. Essentially, a lot of what I'm gonna talk about is drawn from a New Yorker article that I read by Hua Xu, so I'll link it so that I'm not just plagiarizing his ideas, but his article is fascinating. So one of the biggest critics of Maxine Hong Kingston when this book came out was a guy named Frank Chin. Maxine Hong Kingston's parents immigrated to the U.S. I guess this would have been like in the 50s. Is that correct? Yeah, like, no, maybe that's too early. Like the 60s, I guess. But regardless, she's first generation Chinese, whereas Frank Chin, he considers himself fifth generation Chinese American. My understanding is he was part of a group that really started to create a voice and an identity for Chinese Americans and really embodying like a hyphenated identity. Like he considered himself Chinese American, which is different from a Chinese who has just immigrated to the US. He says, as far as I'm concerned, Americanized Chinese who have come over in their teens and later to settle here, and the American-born Chinaman have nothing in common, culturally, intellectually, and emotionally. Then he has this really radical and reactive view of Maxine Hong Kingston's work, and also I think you could probably apply this to Amy Tan's work. I don't know when the Joylet Club came out, probably after this, but Frank Chin's point of view is that the woman warrior is, quote, another in a long line of chinky autobiographies by Pocahontas yellows blowing the same old mixed up East-West soul struggle. This kind of self-representation, he argued, was a Western construct, and its focus on Chinese misogyny, or the icky gooey evil of Chinese culture, was a self-indulgent play to please white readers. He also criticized Kingston because she plays into this picture of Asians who are described as having an inner resource, some primordial connection to the centuries-old civilizations of a mystical Orient long idealized in the West. So the last thing I want to end on is, and this is the thing that fascinates me, because the reason I'm so interested in this is because I myself have experienced and observed the big difference between Asian Americans and the Asian American experience and like Chinese people in China. I feel like that's very easy to understand and to get a handle of. Like a Chinese person in China is a totally different and distinct identity to a Chinese person who has a hyphenated identity, Chinese American, who was born in the US and has grown up in the US. And it's lovely and wonderful to appreciate your culture, and of course you're gonna have connections to China, but you have a different identity than a person who is Chinese in the sense of lived experience, identity, and certainly nationality. This is fascinating to me because this even draws a line between Chinese Americans who have been in California for generations, which clearly does not happen in Kentucky, where I'm from, and first-generation immigrants who have moved to the U.S., and how in media and in writing, it's always the latter that's depicted, which is fine, and there's definitely space for that and a reason to hear those voices. But I think the thing about what Frank Chin is saying that is very interesting to me is that is also still different than immigrants who have been in the U.S. for longer. And I'm not sure that I want to go down the road of like pitting these groups against each other. Like, I don't think it has to be an inherently combative stance between the two, but although he definitely makes it combative. Part of the reason The Woman Warrior was so palatable to mainstream readers was that it could be read as a story of the traumas associated with immigrant assimilation. Family bonds, the psychology of immigrant households, estrangement from the mother tongue, these became the defining themes of Asian American literature, in part because they were market tested. And then this is something that Hua Xu says in the New Yorker article. Decades after The Woman Warrior, the canonical experience of Asian American life remains the first generation's negotiation of the immigrant household. That's definitely something I want to think a lot more about and to explore more deeply. I do kind of agree with Frank Chin's statement that the most palatable and mainstream story that is consumed by general audiences today when it comes to stories about people of color tend to do with the traumas of being an immigrant, trying to assimilate. You know, the generation gap, the all the fighting that happens between a young Americanized protagonist and her parents. And I'm really curious to learn more about immigrant groups that have a longer history in the U.S. For Woman Warrior, I would give it an 8 out of 10. Definitely a high score just because I enjoyed reading it a lot. I found it both powerful in an emotional way, as well as intriguing in an intellectual way, but I kind of did feel like it was a bit cheesy and pandering to a certain audience. I mean, I just don't know who really refers to themselves in these, like, you know, I'm gonna talk story now. And that's just like my judgment. I have no way of knowing. Like, perhaps these things are quite real to her and quite authentic to her, and the time in which she was writing, like in the 70s, when it was definitely much more jarring and definitely much more palpable, the tension that you would feel as a Chinese in, as a Chinese American in the US. So maybe I'm just being anachronistic, and as a modern reader, I think it's putting on airs, but actually that really is how she feels and how she describes things. This video is already way too long, so I'm not going to talk about the last book, but I will let you know what it was. I also read The Future of Another Timeline, which came out in 2019, and it was written by Annalee Newitz. I read this with my friends Karen and Ginny, which is like my other informal book club, and I rated it a 6.5 out of 10. The premise was interesting. It's essentially a time travel novel where a group of women are trying to move throughout time to make sure that abortion is always a right for women. The premise was interesting, but sometimes it jumped the shark a little bit and went a little bit too unrealistic in some of the portrayals. But it was cool how Newitz wove in these real-life historical events into a kind of dramatized sci-fi novel to have a page-turner in terms of the plot, and also to get across some points around women's rights and how much further we have to go. If you've made it this far, thank you so much for watching this video. I learned a lot in terms of how I can make the next one much shorter. And if you read any of these books, please let me know. I would love to discuss them more with you. And until next time, thanks for watching. That's the other thing. There's like too many like bodily fluid. I mean, it's great to normalize the fact that we all have bodily fluids, but I just don't necessarily want to read about it for a long time. Because he's now in academia, it's also very deep, in the sense that he is welcomed back home as if she was a son, and treated the same way as if she was a son. So it really does provide as if she was a son. But now I'm just rambling. Oh my god, I'm so tired. Okay. Can you tell how blonde my hair is? What's that word?